The world's fourth largest iron ore miner has been shooting the lights out. It's posted a 280% surge in half-year profit to about $3.7 billion. And investors are sharing in the bonanza with an increased dividend equivalent to 76 US cents a share, up from 30 cents the same time a year ago. And it's a big payday for FMG founder Andrew Forrest, with reports he'll be pocketing almost $700 million in dividend payouts. On a good day for investors, I caught up with CEO Elizabeth Gaines. Elizabeth Gaines, welcome to the business.
Great to be with you, Rachel.
Elizabeth, a near 300% jump in profit. The corks must be popping. Is that sustainable?
Well, we're certainly very pleased with that first half performance. And in terms of sustainability, we had record shipments of 88.6 million tonnes on the back of record processing. We've also maintained our position as the lowest cost producer. We have an industry-leading cost position. So we're demonstrating that we're the best operator in the iron ore business, that we're the lowest cost and we're generating very strong margins. In addition, we've got our growth projects. So Eliwana and our Ironbridge projects are two significant projects, an important part of our strategy to get us to the position where the majority of our products are at greater than 60% iron content. So those growth projects will continue to deliver outstanding returns to shareholders.
As you said, it's a good payday for shareholders, also for FMG founder Twiggy Forrest. Is this a message to those short sellers of the past?
Well, we've seen those short seller positions actually reduce significantly. So I think that this does underpin that we have an outstanding performance, that we've got our balance sheet into fantastic shape. You can see our net debt at 5%, so our gearing ratio at 5%. So we're in an incredibly strong position. I think the days of the short selling might have been in the past when the company had higher debt levels, but we've been very disciplined in our capital management. We've repaid $9 billion of debt. Our gross debt's at $4 billion on investment grade terms and conditions. So this is a very different business, and we are delivering those outstanding returns to shareholders.
You have, as you mentioned, shipped record volumes. Of course, there's been less competition from Vale. FMG clearly has made hay while the sun shines. Do you see coronavirus, though, casting a shadow on that environment?
Well, I think just touching first on making hay while the sun shines. I mean, importantly for us, we've delivered a different product strategy. So we saw a 73% increase in our average realised price in the first half during a time where the benchmark increased by 38%. So we've outperformed the benchmark, and we did that through a deliberate strategy. We introduced a new product, the 60.1% FE grade West Pilbara fines. So it's been very strategic, and it's not just about taking advantage of the conditions. It's actually about delivering on a strategy and importantly on our product strategy. In terms of the current impact of the coronavirus, what we're seeing actually is that our shipments are continuing unaffected as per our schedule. We're obviously monitoring the situation very closely, but we've got ships that are currently being unloaded in China. So our shipping schedule has been unaffected. Iron ore inventories at ports in China are not increasing, so they're staying at relatively stable levels. We've also seen some supply side disruption more recently due to weather events in the Pilbara and in Brazil. So there has been some impact on supply, but coupled with the fact that all of our steel mill customers are still producing steel, and there's still that strong demand for seaborne iron ore.
Yesterday, BHP boss Mike Henry told this program that he would be concerned if the coronavirus impacts continue beyond March 31. Do you share that time frame of concern?
Well, I think BHP are probably looking across their portfolio of commodities. What we actually see at this time of the year is construction activity in China is relatively subdued anyway. We would anticipate that there will be an increase in construction activity. Construction activity is obviously steel intensive, and that leads to that strong demand for steel and also for iron ore. We do know at the moment that there are some challenges in China for our steel mill customers with moving the finished products. So steel inventories are actually increasing because there are some transport and logistic challenges currently. So we'll be watching that very closely and seeing how that unfolds as we go into what is usually that seasonal uptick in construction activity come April.
Of course, we are hearing almost daily of factories closing, production lines halting. How do you see this playing out for the second half?
Oh, look, it is difficult to predict. I think one of the things for our sector, for iron ore, is less about the factories. It's more about those projects. So those construction projects, the property projects. As I mentioned, we would expect that activity seasonally would increase come the spring weather and come sort of April. So we'll look at that quite carefully. We also know that the Chinese government have recently reiterated their commitment to achieving their growth targets for 2020. And part of that might be through investment in further infrastructure. So as a stimulus to the economy, we may actually see some further investment in infrastructure. That investment tends to be steel intensive, which again would underpin that strong demand for seaborne iron ore.
Of course, we saw Cyclone Damien come through the Pilbara this month. We've had a summer of increased natural disasters. What is FMG doing in terms of its climate policies?
Well, I think just in touching on Cyclone Damien, that was the third weather event we've had this season. That's not unusual. We generally see about five either cyclones or tropical lows in the Pilbara over our typically wet seasons. So fortunately for us, nobody was injured and we're actually back full production. We were railing throughout the whole event. I think when it comes to climate change more broadly, we're getting on with those very practical initiatives, which are a real hallmark of Fortescue. We've recently announced three major energy investments and projects, and once completed, we will actually be generating 25 to 30% of our stationary energy requirements from solar. So we're looking at large-scale renewable through solar and a gas-solar hybrid generation project to make sure that we continue to reduce our emissions, keep our costs low, but importantly, we get energy efficiency.
Elizabeth Gaines, great to have you on the program. Thank you.
Thanks, Rachel.